Waters close over us. It's a journey along the Narmada, and it's a non-fiction book based around my own journey from the sort of source of the Narmada to the mouth of the Narmada, and it's loosely structured around a pilgrimage that is associated with the Narmada called the Parikrama, and that Parikrama is unique to pilgrimages related to rivers in India. The Parikrama basically is traditionally a three-year-long journey, which sort of can begin anywhere on the banks of the river. The river is kept to the right, and a pilgrim with almost nothing, no possessions, starts walking along the banks of the river, keeping the river to the right, seeks shelters in the villages that lie along the way, is fed in those villages, crosses the river only at the mouth, comes back to the source, Samarkantak, and then back to the place where he started from, he or she, and finally goes to the island of Omkareshwar, which is sort of centered along the course of the Narmada, does a circumambulation of the island, and that's the end of the Parikrama. So the Parikrama is a device which lets me structure the book, and the Narmada itself is fascinating. It's sort of a dividing line between cultures, you know, tribal, non-tribal, the south and the north in this country, dams, environmentalists, people who believe in the idea of progress, people who don't, the BJP and the RSS trying to find headway with the tribals. So all of these issues become part of this narrative, and the Parikrama is the device that lets me structure the book. Well, two, three things. One is that I've grown up in Madhya Pradesh, so I know the state well. The second, I was posted back there as a state correspondent for the Indian Express. So I reported for the Indian Express from Madhya Pradesh for 2 or 3 years. Obviously, the dams were coming up, so these issues were very much in the news. But I thought that there was a larger story to be told around the Narmada due to my own personal experiences. And then I left Madhya Pradesh, went and joined Tehalka in Delhi, quit. And I had maybe a year or two where I didn't want to work, stay with a job. I had very little money, but I mean, the economy of the Narmada is such that very little money goes a very long way. And that is what I did. I spent maybe a year, year and a half in stretches traveling along the river. I think the entire travel would have cost me less than a lakh over a period of time. This was done before advances were the norm with books. So that had sort of enormous advantages because I was not tied down to a proposal or a pre-structured idea. I mean, there was a sense of letting things happen, experiencing stories and letting the structure build up. So it's been in the writing for 6 or 7 years in sort of the travel and the writing, and it's finally come to an end where I think I'm reasonably satisfied with the product that I have. To me, I'm a generalist. I'm an engineer by training. I then went and studied mathematics before I came to journalism. The reason I came to journalism is that I like to deal with a lot of interesting subjects at the same time. And I think all the issues that you mention are issues of interest. So it is the coming together of this diversity of subjects all centered around the Narmada that interested me. And I thought that was a story to be told, which was sort of quite different from an ordinary travelogue in the normal sense. And that is what I have attempted to do in this case. It is not a novel. It's a very much observed non-fiction. So everything there is what I have seen, what I have experienced, what I've heard. Of course, since it's a narrative tale, it's not a history. So hearsay, as Alberini says, is sometimes far more interesting and reliable than eyewitness. And I sometimes tend to believe in a travel book when you're traveling and hearing these wonderful stories. And actually, the book starts at the source at Amarkantak. The Gond tribals are located there. And among the Gonds are these fascinating set of poet, musicians there who sort of carry the religion of the Gonds, the Pardhans, and they are storytellers, you know. So the book begins with this art of oral storytelling that is almost lost to us. And some of the terrain, which is why I was always interested in what Ram Guha had to say, was the warrior elven, people like that, the history of the Gonds, all that intersect with this. But the Pardhans bring an idea of narrative that we are losing today, you know, of storytelling that is passed down generations, but a story that changes with every telling and comes alive with every telling, and how that differs from how we structure narrative today. And that is where the story begins, and it ends up at the other extreme among another set of tribal people, the Bhils, who have been far more impacted by modernity and changes, where, you know, most of our contemporary Indian debates on what kind of development actually works, what kind of development is sustainable, what is happening with the saffronization of the tribals, how these things come together, what the results are. So all these issues in different ways are taken up in the book. Well, the structure is in some ways straightforward. I follow the course of the Narmada. But so each chapter is loosely located at a place that follows the progress of a pilgrim along the river. But in beginning to tell the story of one particular idea, one place, I often have to go back to the beginning of the journey or go ahead to the end of the journey even when I have not reached that point in the narrative. So it is not completely a linear structure. That is just a device that gives me a place to start a chapter. And then a chapter may unfold by going back and forth along the river. What is often called this way of traveling along the river is given a name. It's called a Bandar Parikrama. So in some ways, what I have done is use the idea of a Bandar Parikrama, because as you said, it's not just cultural, social. I think some of the central religious ideas of India have unfolded here. The enlightenment of Sankara was at Omkareshwar. And this is not incidental. If you look at the geographical map of India and you look at how Sankara visualized India or whatever he may have understood by the geographical term, you have the mutts which he has set up with a clear idea of geography. But his enlightenment is described here at the center of this river, and that's almost at the very heart of India. But at that very heart of India, you don't see classical Hinduism today. You see various kinds of tribal religions, yogini cults, all coming together. So in some ways, at the very center of India, at the very origins of classical Hinduism, everything else exists today and is still very much part of that river and the tradition. Well, I mean, all of us know that, unfortunately, and I think erroneously, because the evidence actually goes against the Supreme Court judgment which made the dams possible. If you go back and critically examine the evidence that comes up before the court, and then you look at the conclusions the majority judgment draws, obviously the majority judgment does not follow from the evidence that came before the court. The Supreme Court clearly in that judgment proposed a certain sense of beliefs about development. I mean, the Supreme Court majority judgment says that the tribals will obviously be much better off after rehabilitation. That's a belief which is not borne out by anything on the ground. If you actually look at how rehabilitation has taken place, how it has unfolded, it has actually made the situation far worse than what they originally were. And I think it's very difficult to displace tribals who are rooted in a place and a community in a way that other populations are not. I'm not saying that rehabilitation should be done wherever it can, but certain people are more easily rehabilitated than others, and in case of tribals, it's almost impossible, as I said. And I think the Supreme Court failed to realize this, failed to realize the impact of the dams, the calculations that went into building of the dam, the mathematical calculations which justified the economic rationale of the dam. Those calculations are wrong, and today are proven to be wrong, because the dam, which should have been delivering benefits, if you do the cost-benefit ratio, will never pay for itself. It will never deliver the results that were promised when it was sanctioned. But unfortunately, they are a reality. They've turned this river, which may perhaps be the oldest river in India, into a cascading series of dams right from the source to the mouth of the sea. I report, I analyze. I don't think anybody would be presumptuous enough to offer prescriptions and solutions. I do feel that as a civilization, we have failed to come to terms with modernity. We picked up modernity piecemeal, believed in the idea of big projects, big dams, without understanding the kind of economic rationale or the thinking and planning that often goes into it. And I'm just picking up one example. It is happening with religion. You know, I have seen Jyotirling temples on the Omkareshwar island being refurbished in the image of a hotel lobby. And this is what our modernity has come to. To me, that is some kind of analysis of what we are seeing unfolding in this country. To me, a Narendra Modi is a symptom of exactly this kind of thing. when we come to believe that a good-looking hotel lobby is our idea of the sacred, then we can come to believe that Narendra Modi is our idea of a good leader. And I think this is what has happened. Prescriptions? No, I don't think I can give any prescriptions. This is what has unfolded. It is far too vast, far too deep-rooted in this country to be undone by a few simple prescriptions. It's something that will change over a time where we actually have no way out but to come to terms with modernity in all its sort of complications. And we have so far refused to do so. That's what I believe. Largely, but I allowed myself a few deviations when necessary for the sake of the narrative.